Hey, this is Fuzzy, and welcome to the Fuzzy Underground. Today I'm talking about cover songs with Piotr from Seum, a sludge trio out of Montreal. They recently released a killer cover of the Prince song, The Marrying Kind, so I'll ask them all about it, how they picked the song, and how to handle the licensing. We also get into how the band came up with their signature bass-only sound, hear about their upcoming news, and get a few band shout-outs. But first, just released today on the Swamp Records is the pre-release album and CD from Electric Cult. This stoner sludge four-piece is from Mexico and delivers heavy riffs with tough vocals. Get a two-sided full-color lyric sheet poster when you get the CD from theswamprecords.com. You'd already have Electric Cult in your Bandcamp collection if you were in the Swamp Krewe. That's my Bandcamp subscription where you get over 151 digital albums and new music every week with the option to get swag and a CD every month with free worldwide shipping. Support the underground when you get some heavy music and merch. Join the Swamp Krewe at theswamprecords.com. Today I'm talking to Piotr, the bass player of Montreal-based trio Seum. These guys have a great bass-only sludge sound, which we'll talk about later. But first I wanted to find out how they chose the Prince song, The Marrying Kind.
We had the EP out for already 2 months at that time when we released the Prince cover, and we didn't have enough time to compose and record something full length. But we were thinking it would be cool to come with something fresh, new, and original. So that's how the cover came, you know. Like and Prince specifically. It's we are all fans of Prince. And I was really pushing for that specific cover because for small things like first of all the My Name Is Prince album is I think is the first album I purchased as a kid, so that was a little high five with myself from the past. And also I was playing music for very long, but then I traveled a bit. I was living in Japan before, so. But anyway, long story short, I didn't play music for quite a few years, and the thing that got me back to being active is actually Prince show that he made. I think he played in, when was that? 2014 in France. I would have to confirm that, but it was his last show in France, and I was lucky enough to get tickets for it, and it was insane. I think he came back maybe three times. Like he was on fire. So you know, like this was these two little high fives with myself, and I was really pushing for it to be Prince. And yeah. I was happy that that Gaspar and Fred were okay with that. And you know, like Prince is so much into grooves, right? Like I mean, melodies as of course, but he's he has a very uncanny way of making his riffs groove. And since it's kind of the core of what we want to do with Seum, like we really work hard, you know, on having this this kind of little bit weird grooves, you know, that you move your head, but you don't really know when it's suddenly like you're offbeat, you know. So we love this kind of thing. Yeah. So having a Prince cover was kind of, you know, making sense.
Yeah, and you actually ended up doing two versions, right? Because
yes.
You is one just without Prince, or is there more of a difference to it than that?
So no, it's the only difference. The thing is, it was more for fun. The thing is, the initial cover was only with Gaspar on vocals, but then Fred he's just for the little background. He's working on microphones. Like he's really into audio and text from the text aspect. You know, like a kind of hardware audio aspect, and he loves all these things, and he's really much into recording plugins and stuff. And so he found that crazy plugin where you can pass a song and you can just excerpt some specific frequencies. So he managed to get Prince voice, and
yeah,
that way we could inject it into the song. And but for obvious, you know, like copyright reasons, we couldn't really exploit it. Like we couldn't really release it. So I know a couple of podcasts had that song. I think the Electric Stoner played it. I think Sarah Wisbanger as well, but I would have to check it. But yeah, so we couldn't really release it so much, but it was fun to have, you know, like this little little fun version.
Right. Well, and I think the version you gave me for my CD mixtape, I think is the version without
See, and these are really interesting things, I think, for other bands that want to do covers. This gives them options. You know, that was mm-hmm. a really clever way for you guys to do that. You know, you did the version you really wanted, but then to be practical, you know, you take his vocals off so you don't have some of the problems with the licensing exactly. and things. And we'll talk more about that in a little bit, because that sure. I think is maybe what holds back a lot of bands from really wanting to pursue doing a cover. So once you guys decided to do the Prince song, did you sort of have to scratch your heads a little bit and think like, how are we going to approach it? Or did you immediately know how you wanted it to sound?
I knew it would be Prince. We were thinking about it for a while, but I mean, Prince was just like getting all these cross checks, you know, like that was the artist we wanted to do. And then he has so many famous songs. I think it would have been a little bit too easy to go with a famous single. So so we just decided for a little less known song, and the album which features that song, Musicology, is like a hidden masterpiece of Prince. So that was also a cool aspect of it. But once we chose the song, it went pretty smoothly. Like Fred did the drums. I was kind of trying to find. I had to, obviously, because we only use bass, so I had to simplify the melody a bit. But the most difficult aspect was the vocals, because Prince has a very, like, he's singing, but he also has some sort of like flow, you know, like a kind of like funk flow. So having to scream that was very difficult. And I know Gaspar spent a lot of time working on that. So actually he had the more work on that cover song.
There's a lot of bands, when you talk to them, they don't really want to do covers. They sort of think like, oh yeah, I don't want to do covers. We only want to play our own music. Do you ever hear that from other bands?
To be honest, like we had the same approach at the very beginning. Like we were like, no, we're just going to play our songs. But then again, you know, like with this lockdown and the COVID thing, like you just start thinking differently. So we just thought like, yeah, let's try it on one song and see how is the reception, like if we have fun playing it, doing it. Obviously it's not our own song, but yeah, like it's very fun, you know, to reinterpret, you know, and to try to give it another vibe, especially when you do something so opposite of your spectrum, you know, like like Prince is literally not sludge, not stoner, you know, like nothing related to metal somehow, you know. So that was super fun.
And then at what point did you guys start to go like, oh wait, we're gonna have to take care of the licenses and stuff? Like at what point did you have to start getting serious about how to approach it?
So the thing is, at the very beginning, we were thinking like, okay, let's just release it and not think about it. And then I started reading stuff online, and that was a very common mistake made by bands. I could find it very often, you know, like, don't do it. And so I started investigating a bit, like how we could do it. So at the very beginning, what we wanted to do is just to release it on Bandcamp first, because even though our songs are available on Spotify and other streaming platforms, like we really focus on Bandcamp. I think at the moment, for a small band like us, and I think it's a very humble recommendation, but I think for small bands, it's really the go-to platform. So for streaming, we just went to, actually, you know what, I have some proper companies' names to recommend. So there's these two websites, Affordable Song Licensing and Easy Song Licensing. And so we use them both, actually, because first we just purchased some licenses for streaming. And then when we had the opportunity to do the compilation, the mixtape with you, then we purchased some extra licenses, you know, for CD. And it's not that expensive. I think for Bandcamp, it cost us $20, $20, pretty much the same price for the CD. So obviously it's some money, but it's worth investing. And at least you're sure that you won't be strike down, you know, like you don't want to have your account canceled by Bandcamp. You don't want to have a strike on YouTube. So yeah, it's worth it. Then for for Spotify and streaming platforms, it's a different animal, because depending on how you and your band get to the streaming platforms, if you use a distributor, then you can enter all this information into that distributor when you submit your song. So in our case, we use amuse.io. So I think it's a good provider. They're very cheap because they're free. So so that's why we chose them. But so far we don't have to complain. So the thing that you have to do there is when you enter your song, you enter it as a cover. You put the original artist there as the composer. And then the royalty is going to be calculated automatically. So you don't really have to worry about it.
Right. And you don't have to pay the license.
No, exactly. For Spotify, no. For Bandcamp. Bandcamp and for YouTube.
Right. That's what I tell bands. If they want to do a cover, but they don't have the money for the licensing, then I say, well, then just put it on Spotify and let them take care of it. You know, don't.
Exactly.
The cover art for that single that you guys did for the Prince song was killer, right?
Oh, yes.
It was awesome.
That's cool because we were mentioning Death Gang, and I think it's the drummer, right? Dying Watan.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, actually I discovered him, I think through, I think he did some art for you like some time ago. I think he did some
He did a logo for me, yeah.
Okay. And I think I discovered him like that. Then I was following him on Instagram, and I mean we were really digging his style, because he has a very specific particular style. And so yeah, we came with this idea to revisit the, you know, like the Prince 1999 cover, but make a sludge version of it.
So let me ask you about the bass setup, because that's what's maybe, you know, you guys have a lot of unique stuff going on, but the bass setup is definitely very unique.
Yeah, that's one thing I wanted to talk about, because it's that was one thing we had to work on at the very beginning, because at first we started without just with the regular bass going through an overdrive, and the thing is the sound is too thin somehow. Like you really feel that there's something missing. There's some frequencies, like these guitar frequencies are missing. So we were looking for a solution, and right now what we do is we only have one bass, so I'm only playing one bass, but we split the sound into two different amps. So basically we have one signal going through a fuzz, going through a wah, and to the bass amp. So that's what we call the basic bass sound. And then we have also what we call the guitar sound, even though it's not a guitar. It's the bass plugged on an equalizer, just to kill the very low frequencies, and then on a guitar amp. So it's still very low, but you have a different type of frequencies. It's like a very, very low tuned guitar. And we noticed that combining them together, like it gives you, like you kind of get all these frequencies of the spectrum. So when you listen to it, like you don't feel that there is something lacking. So up until now, like we didn't hear any complaints. That was my biggest concern at first, that people will be like, oh, okay, that's cool, but it becomes very boring because it's always the same sound. But here, you know, like we have these two channel, and we can switch from one to the other. We can sometimes we're gonna put some wah, sometimes we're gonna remove the fuzz, and that way we can have many different sounds, and the music doesn't get repetitive, you know, like with this setting.
And I think you kind of mentioned to me you guys are working on a new album or a new EP. What's the what's coming up for you guys?
Yes. So the thing is, since the first EP was Summer of Seum, the idea is what we have now is the Winter of Seum. So the whole idea was to go more extreme. So when it's slow, it's slower. When it's angry, it's angrier. When there's melodies, there's more melodies. So we kind of tried to go, just like a good follow-up, you know, like with movies, right? Like you have Alien, and then you have Aliens, right?
Sequel, yeah.
Exactly. So we wanted to do the same. Now what concerns me is that if we want to keep the name, which I find very cool, Winter of Seum, we're gonna have to be hitting the studio very soon, and I hope this lockdown won't last for too long.
Yeah.
Otherwise, that's we're gonna release it in the spring, you know, and then we're gonna have to change the name. eventually issue Summer of Some on CDs. So that's going to happen very soon with the Prince track as a bonus.
Oh, nice.
So we're also working still on the vinyl. So that was a whole. We should do a whole interview only about that. But yeah, let's not make it too long. But basically, the whole cover thing, we really want to make it different, and it's difficult to get the right companies to print it and to get it affordable. So basically, the compromise we found is that the whole gatefold cover gonna be printed by a professional company, and then the pop-up inside we're gonna cut it and paste it ourselves, so it's gonna be a lot of fun. I want to shout out to Rexxar, which is a band. Actually, I think they're like kind of like the little brothers of Death Gang, and I discovered them on your sampler, and we're in touch with them since then, and they're really cool. I know they're recording their first album right now, so I'm really curious to hear it. We have some brother bands in Paris, Dpatrol and Cerbere. So Dpatrol, I know they're recording right now, so the first EP, so it should be out in the next weeks, next months, I hope. Cerbere, another band, so actually they're members of Lord Humongous, so previous Gaspar's band. So these guys went fully they really follow like the dark path, like they're playing sludge mixed with black metal. It's really brutal. So it's the EP is already recorded. Like, we had the luck to listen to it. It's awesome. I know they started being active on Instagram. So last one. Actually, I think it's a band that doesn't really need shout outs because they have enough followers already. But the thing is, we have this huge band in Paris named this Hangman Chair. So I don't know if you're familiar with it, but I think they're really the biggest doom band in France right now. So I recommend you guys to listen to them. And the drummer started a new project called the Rune of the Romantics, and it's really great.
Thanks so much to Piotr of Seum for taking the time to speak with me. I especially dig the part where he talks about how they developed his unique bass sound. Check out their EP and cover song on Bandcamp. The links for everything are in the show notes. Catch you next time on the Fuzzy Underground.